open the Capital Improvement Planning Committee meeting at 5:03 p.m. on October 18th. I'm just pulling up the agenda here. All right, so we actually, unfortunately, don't have minutes from the last meeting. The person who was keeping minutes, I actually recall didn't actually take any for the last meeting. So we can actually just skip right into election of officers. So we do need a chair and also a clerk. So
I'm nominating Mark as chair again. And,
I second that.
And then, yeah, but I was going to ask Chuck to be the clerk.
Don't you have to do one at a time?
Well, I don't know. We have two. I guess we could do one at a time. So you second that?
I do.
All right. So I guess all those in favor? Actually, we have to do a roll call. So we'll start with Carolyn.
Yes.
All right. And then Denise?
Yes.
And then Chuck?
Yes.
And then, what was your name again?
Carrie.
All right. And then Carrie?
Yes.
All right. That's too many people with C's. And then Mark Brennan, yes. All right. Am I missing anyone? I don't think so.
Yeah. Wait,
okay, cool. All right. So, then we need to find a clerk for this committee as well.
I was going to see if Chuck would mind.
Is there anyone here who would be interested? Chuck, would you be interested?
If no one else was interested, I could certainly do that.
It's really, it is literally just official. That's all. I mean, it's
okay.
Not.
Yeah. I'm fine doing that. Yep.
I second that.
All right. Okay. And then let's see here.
Motion second.
Yeah. So who made the motion?
I did.
Oh, you did. And then who's the second? Was that Denise? Okay. All right. So all those in favor, we'll start with Carolyn.
Yes.
All right. And then Denise.
Yes.
And then Chuck.
Yep.
Yes. And then Mark Brennan, yes. And then was it Emily?
Carrie.
Oh, Carrie. Oh, wow. Carrie. Yeah. I didn't report it the last time. Too many C names, Carrie. Yes. Okay. All right. Great. So that'll be the last time I make that mistake. All right. Great. So we're all set there. And then the next thing we have to talk about is the capital projects. So we have four capital projects that we need to discuss. We have, does everyone have their packet? Does anyone not have a packet?
Well, I don't have one because I'm sitting here and it's on my laptop and I'm, yeah. So I've read through everything.
Read through everything. Okay, great.
Yeah.
Do you have first stuff or have an electronic copy?
Yeah. Yep.
All right. So we also have Lily Dwight here. Lily, are you here to talk about the St. James Church property?
Only if you need me, but that's why I'm here. Yes.
All right. Well, why don't we start with that? So the first thing that we have to review is the purchase of the St. James property for senior housing. So I believe that we were just in the process of waiting for an assessment for this. So I think that finally came through. So we finally have an amount, right? Is that correct?
Correct.
$420,000, and we have an offer to purchase signed by the owner.
All right. So
and that is $40,000 less than the appraised value, just for the record. Thank you, Casey.
All right. And then this would be for the purchase using CPA funds, I believe, right?
Correct.
Okay. And then I guess the only question that I had was when we get to the next phase of this project, you know, like, do we know how much money we would be looking at for, you know, what we're going to do with this building? And, you know, is there anything else that comes along with this purchase that we need to do? Like, do we need to pay for removing anything? Or, you know, are there any other costs associated, I guess, with this, you know, other than just the initial purchase?
The timing of your asking this is perfect because we had a meeting yesterday with community housing folks over at Sanderson Place, and somebody asked that question, but all costs are borne by the developer. And the action of the town in purchasing the property and delivering it to be developed is a well-received skin in the game that funders look for, especially for tax credits and stuff, to see the community support. So following the Sunderland model, which is where we're headed now, the town would not bear any additional cost for the development. However, it does take it off the tax rolls until that happens.
Yep.
That's it.
I would just like to add that it's the flexibility that's hugely important here, because we haven't done are not committed to a confirmed siting. And so the flexibility of this additional property that would allow us to site different things, you know, or how we're going to do the senior housing model is really important.
As well as it expands the green space of the municipal campus and gives the town the ability to manage more of the Bloody Brook stuff that Carolyn's been working on. The Bloody Brook will come under the town purview with this addition.
Does anyone else have any other questions on this particular request? The only other question I had is, if we were to demolish the buildings, who would pay for that?
So this is not set in stone, obviously, but it would be the developer. So the process would be that the senior housing committee, working with the town planner, will develop the RFP. And also Christine Medore has volunteered from the Denise, what's her title?
She's the Mass Housing Authority.
Mass Housing Authority is so excited about what we're doing with the municipal campus. She's volunteered to help us write the RFP, which is pretty sweet, for no money. So the goal would be that we would not be paying for whatever transpires.
Oh, sure.
Just a question as far as, and I assume we've talked with like RDI or other developers and that they are interested. My concern is, we purchase this property, own these two buildings, and wind up with developers coming in and say, well, it's not really worth, you know, doing senior housing here. Have there been,
yes.
I just didn't want to hang on to get new buildings and find out like, we're stuck with two buildings.
Right. We did. You mean specifically around this particular property?
Yes, this specific property. We buy the property and then the developers come in and say, look, it just isn't worth the cost to take down the buildings, rehab this space. There's not enough space. It isn't worth doing senior housing here. And now we own the property and the buildings. And
that specifically has not happened, but we did do a demand analysis. And in the course of that, the consultant that we did it with identified such a high demand that she said to us, look, I know like six developers who would just love this. And a lot of it has to do with the actual siting being on the municipal campus, right? That's what we were just talking about generally before. So I that is a legitimate concern. However, all our studies to date have shown that we know our need is really high. We have 80 people who said they'd move in tomorrow, or I don't know how many of them are still alive, but whatever. They were replaced by others, no doubt. And the market feasibility that is required by any developer has been done and is exceedingly strong, especially for this for this site when I'm talking municipal campus generally. We have not specifically identified this site that, you know, with the St. James property on it. However, I will point out that Sanderson had the place had a farmhouse on it that RDI converted into three units of senior housing, as well as building their very large thing. So there, we have a very local example of them addressing existing structures.
Yeah. Okay. Just wondered what our exposure is all.
Denise?
I've got a question. So Lily, so this would be a friendly 40B. So I think we had talked before, if it were to be an unfriendly 40B, a developer could come in and build whatever the heck they wanted to, could be something that the town is really not interested in. So, you know, in addition to this being for senior housing, I think it really does protect the town against something that we wouldn't want happening. So I don't know if you want to expand on that.
Well, I think you've elucidated it quite nicely, that this actually is both a positive and a preventative, because we have no affordable housing. Well, no, we have very little affordable housing that an unfriendly 40B, this would be a prime site for someone to purchase and put up multifamily housing, and they can walk all over our zoning laws.
Yeah, just one other question. Since a number of the seniors that would be moving into this would be considered low income, wouldn't that make our grant possibilities greater because we would have a greater population of low income individuals or not?
You mean a grant for
future grants? Because, you know, that's a problem, because our median household income is very high. It's very skewed in Deerfield. Yeah, it's running.
So the local preference is up to 70% of the houses. In Sunderland, it's all subsidized, and I would expect that we would do the same because of looking at the demographics and the need in town and the economics of the people who need it. So let's assume this is all subsidized housing that would go toward protecting us against an unfriendly 40B as well.
Okay, thanks.
We might be proposing that, or at least in my mind, to make sure that it is truly subsidized housing, is yes, we put the dedicated housing money in the CPA every year towards, you know, some kind of deal with the contractor to make sure that, you know, to cut his costs so that the units are truly subsidized, fully subsidized. There's different subsidization amounts, and I, you know, the lowest subsidy amount filled up immediately in Sunderland, and I want to make sure that we have the highest amount of units that you know, take care of our lowest income seniors.
Yes, but it all has to pencil out, right?
I know. That's just saying.
Yeah.
There could be other requests in the future related to this, but not, you know, I don't want to complicate it because we don't know. It's all speculative.
All of our data show right now that we, especially considering the average age in town is only getting older, that we will be able to have residents in have Deerfield residents in this housing for the foreseeable future.
Yeah,
good. And then one other question I had is, you know, I know when we first talked about this, we talked about, you know, trying to keep at least the facade of the church and the house that comes associated with it. And I think the pendulum's kind of swung the other way. Where do we think this nets out now with keeping the facade of the building?
Our process has been to have public meetings galore. And we've done three, I think now, Denise, with the folks from Boston.
Yeah, VHB, yeah.
Yeah, VHB. And we've got at least, I think, three more on the plan in the contracts with Berkshire Design as well. And they're supposed to come up with three new ideas as well. Yeah. And I think that it is not out of the question to keep the facade. However, and we can make it really clear about this is what the community wants. And because the people who are most likely to be the developers are RDI, working with Valley, another nonprofit, the ones who built Sunderland.
Oh, Valley CDC.
Thank you.
Yeah, Laura Baker.
That sort of partnership, they're very aware of neighborhood characteristics and the importance of it and what people in the town want. There are no guarantees. I mean, you're absolutely right, especially if the facade is super expensive to maintain. And if they say, do you want, we can afford to either maintain this facade for something or build another unit of senior housing, I gotta tell you, I know how I go. but we're not there yet. And there's nothing saying we're gonna tear it down and nothing saying that we're gonna keep it. It's just like, let's get this and let's get the designers and have people come in and actually look at the structure and stuff.
Yeah. Well, seems strategic not to make any promises. All right. Well, does anyone have a motion to recommend, or unless anyone has any other questions? I've got Casey and Denise. Did you have your hand up as well?
Well, I was going to make a motion to recommend.
Oh, sure.
But Casey,
I just had one question. Do you want to prioritize this, because I think this is a pre-approved project? Yeah. I was thinking about it because I'm sitting here looking at the spreadsheet so I can update it. I just wondered if you guys wanted to think about that. So I'll bow out and you guys do your motion.
Yeah, I think what we'll do is we'll just make the motions and then we'll prioritize after we have the motions all knocked out.
I'll second that motion.
Okay.
All right. All those in favor, we'll start with Carolyn.
Yes.
Denise.
Yes.
Then we have Chuck.
Yes.
And Carrie.
Yes.
And Mark Brennan, yes. All right. So that passes.
Thank you. You don't need me for anything else, do you?
No, we do not.
You can eat your supper, Denise. I mean, Leland.
Yeah, that would be the other one. Bye. Thank you.
Well, I'll sit here and starve till we're finished. Hey, so I would make a motion since we approved this last year, the 500,000 or whatever it was, 502,000. I would consider this a priority. I don't see why not.
Priority same. One is pre-approved
project. Oh
yeah. I would
highest priority.
Yeah.
Well, plus the money's there. That's not an issue.
Yeah. Yeah. It all makes sense. Yeah. All right, so we have a motion to make this a priority number one. Do we have a second?
Second.
All right, a second. This will do a roll call vote here. So Carolyn?
Yes.
Denise?
Yes.
Chuck?
He said yes.
He says yes. Carrie?
Yes.
And then Mark Brand, yes. So this is priority one. All right. The next thing that we have is the HVAC system for the police department. This is another one that's already been approved like 15 times by this committee.
The price changed.
Yeah, the cost has escalated on this one. So after going out and, you know, getting a bid for this, it I don't remember what the original amount was, but I think it had a one in front of it. And now it has a two. As far as this is concerned, we actually are kind of required to do this. The HVAC, for anyone who wasn't on the committee the first couple times that Chief Petrore came in to talk about this, this is for the HVAC in the area where our holding cells are, among other things. So we kind of do need to do something about that. Yeah, just with like the material increases and supply chain and stuff like that, this had increased.
We are out of compliance, and DCH has not condemned anything because they know we're working on it. You know, we were able to talk to them. We know them well enough that we showed them all the stuff that we're doing. So,
yeah.
But we do have to move forward on this, even though it just seems like an outrageous amount of money. But it is very uncomfortable in there. It is causing damage to the building, you know, and the condensation from the is leaking into the police department. And plus, it gets really bloody hot in there.
It does.
It's really awful for staff, you know, our police work. So I would recommend this, even though I just can't stand the amount of money we're spending. But
yeah.
Put it into our schools instead, but.
Yeah, I know.
Is this heating as well? Is it just air
conditioning?
Yes. It takes the moisture out. Yeah, it's going to be taking
I will put some heat pumps in too, right? That was the last revision that we're going to kind of do.
The last one will allow for heat. Yeah.
For the shoulders.
Yep.
So it's just a gross amount.
It's just the way the world is these days.
Yeah. It is what it is. So
Chuck has a question.
Oh, Chuck.
Chuck, you're muted.
Is it not coming through now? Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah, sorry about that. Just in terms of funding source, it mentions free cash. Are there any other available sources to fund this?
Not really, but also if there are things like CPA funds and stuff where we know that there's going to be like a different funding source for like the purposes of prioritization, we can prioritize them higher, but this committee is not necessarily charged with finding the funding source for it. That would be the finance committee and sometimes the select board. But as of right now, I believe it would be most likely free cash. It could potentially come from other sources. I know that we've talked about ARPA and other stabilization funds in the past. We're not going to be able to use either one of those, I don't believe. So it's most likely going to have to be free cash.
The okay. Leary lot is, we're going to use the ARPA money on the Leary lot. And of course, that price keeps escalating a bit. And so I think what we're going to, we only had the ability to do like the 100 under ARPA. So what we're going to try to do is if this comes in over, the ARPA would fill in, you know, the 10 or 20,000 or some extra money if we had to, but we don't want to use any portion of the ARPA money because we're afraid we're not going to have enough for the Leary lot already. So that's why it was a shift to free cash and then as a safety net ARPA, but we're looking like we're spending our ARPA money right up to the budget anyway.
Thank you.
Denise.
Okay, once again, I make a motion to accept this because we did vote it in 2021. It's unfortunate the price has doubled, which is really annoying in 2 years. But so I make a motion to accept that.
All right, do we have a second?
I'll second.
Oh, put down Chuck.
All right, Chuck gets this one.
Yes,
it's a good question, Chuck. I'll give you the second.
A little diversity here.
Yeah. All right, any discussion, debate or discussion or anything on this one? All right, we'll do the vote. So starting with Carolyn.
Yes.
Denise.
Yes.
Chuck.
Yes.
Gary.
Yes.
Mark Brennan, yes. All right, so that passes 500. And then for the prioritization, this could be a one or a two. We've already pre-approved this several times.
I think it's because it's a public health thing, I would say one.
Yeah, that we have
a two. Holding up one, and Chuck and I are all holding one finger up.
One. Yep.
How much we can do
about anyone that. Want to make a motion on this one?
I'll make a motion for number one.
All right. So any debate or discussion? Do we have a second?
I second that.
All right. Well, Gary gets this one. all right. And then any debate or discussion? Nope. All right. So let's do a roll call here. So Carolyn.
Yes.
Denise.
Yes.
Chuck.
Yes.
Gary.
Yes.
Mark Brennan, yes. All right. The next order of business is the Municipal Vulnerability Preparedness Grant Match. So this one I would like to, I guess, defer to the select board on if one of the members of the select board would like to take this one.
This is our match for green infrastructure that's going to be at the elementary school. Let's see.
Elementary school, the Cleary lot, and the historic Deerfield.
It also has an educational element too.
True.
Okay,
so 2 year grant.
So the 119.
It's split into two fiscal years. I did the best I could when I wrote the application.
Yeah, like
the total amount that we have to have for a grant match for the 2 years, FY 24 and 25, is 92,000, whatever else. 176.
Yeah.
What I tried to do was sort of identify some of the work that was happening in 24 and then the work that was happening in 25.
Okay.
That's why you see the split, Carolyn.
We're moving forward with the Leary lot and we're moving forward with the elementary school. So again, this is good to do because we're trying to support flooding capacity. And this would fund tree boxes, rain gardens, bioswell, swales, and that.
Is this due to
cumulatively, we're going to be adding, like with the Leary lot, and whatever Bloody Brook floods, we're going to calculate that. We have a full-year geomorphologist grant to come and look at the Bloody Brook, help us decide how to keep it healthy. What do we have to do? Get rid of the invasives, plant a buffer, and calculate what is the storage capacity for flood for downtown that we need. And this is part of that calculation. And it just makes sense with climate change moving forward. And we have the grant for the other percentage. Elise.
I've got a question. So when I was reading, I know it's like $97,000, but it also said a match and some can be in kind. So is any of that in kind? I mean, I would, but of course it has to happen within the time frame. So,
the in-kind match happens during the grant process.
Yeah.
This, you actually have to have some sort of a cash match too. This 92,000 is the cash match. The in-kind match would be work the accountant does, work okay. That Chris Nolan does, work that I do, just because that's
mm-hmm.
work that goes towards the purpose of the
group. Right. Okay. All right. Thanks.
Any other questions for Carolyn?
Well, just one more. So if for some reason this did not get voted, is that going to be an issue with completing the Leary lot, which we've been talking about for so many darn years? I'm sort of tired of it. I want to get it done. So, okay. Just
and it also is going to take care of the front of revamping the front of the elementary school.
Right.
It's actually right now. It's not compliant for
repairs
and stuff like that. I mean, it's seriously problematic. And we have stormwater issues over there. So we don't want anything to damage the building. You got to be able to do the storage of the water.
Okay. So I don't have the priorities in front of me because they're, So we've got, what is priority one is the most, and we go down from there. So we've got
two. I'll review the priorities. So priority one is pre-approved and pre-funded projects. Priority two is safety and healthy. Priority three is operational importance or to prevent further damage. Priority four is proactive priorities. And then priority five are others.
Other things you consider.
Okay, great. Yeah. Thanks.
So for this one, we have this as most likely a number two, but we can discuss that after the motion, the first motion. All right, so do we have a motion to recommend this one?
I'll make a motion to recommend.
All right, and do we have a second?
I'll second that.
All right. Any debate or discussion on the municipal vulnerability motion?
The schools have funded a portion of their projects for this as well.
Yeah, I got to get my talking points together on this for the town meeting, but the
Darius school has put a lot of work into this, and they put a lot of money into it too.
Darius has been is overseeing this, which is the in-kind, one of the in-kind matches for them.
Okay, so I guess we'll take a vote then. So, Carolyn.
Yes.
Denise.
Yes.
Chuck.
Yes.
Harry.
Yes.
And Mark Brennan, yes. All right. And then in terms of prioritization, I think, I'm sorry, I misspoke earlier. I said that this, I think we had a two. I think the two was actually footnote number two, saying that it was simply highlighted in orange. So yeah, I think that this one, you know, you could probably make an argument for, you know, maybe one or three. Does anyone have
any ideas? Does it matter that we have all priority one projects here?
I don't know that it does in this case, because we're essentially, Casey, I guess correct me if I'm wrong, but we're essentially just making sure that these items pass through the Capital Improvements Planning Committee simply to get a recommendation either way before the special town meeting, right? So we don't actually have to prioritize this for the Finance Committee.
Right.
I don't think you have to. It's, if you wanted to add any comments, you would tell the board, the select board.
Yeah. I think it would be good just to have them, just in case we need them. But
propose that this is a priority one because we have projects that are undergoing. I mean, that we're starting funded. Right. Yeah, they're funded. They're going. I mean, we're trying to get the Leary lot done before Christmas. But
yeah, that's why I was saying, like, you know, a one would make sense. I mean, it's kind of pre-funded and pre-approved. We've talked about this many a time. This is kind of like the police HVAC, where we've talked about this ad nauseum. So yeah, do you want to make a motion then, Carolyn?
Yes, I'll make a motion. This is a priority one.
All right. Any second?
Second.
I'll second.
All right. Got Carrie already. Quick on the draw. All right. So any debate or discussion on that? All right. So do a roll call vote. Carolyn?
Yes.
And Denise?
Yes.
Chuck?
Yes.
Carrie?
Yes.
And Mark, yes. Mark Brennan, yes. Yeah, right. All right. And then the last one that we have are the road repairs and reconstruction. So these are definitely, there's definitely a lot here. This is another request coming from the select board. So do either of you want to speak? Either you, Carolyn or Trevor, want to speak to this one?
Well, I'll just say July 10th, Ashfield, Chesterfield, Heath, Conway, Deerfield, Levert, Filburn, Wendell, and Adams had damage from storms. Our damage at the July 10th storm was $1.2 million. On the 21st, it was a storm that was really just over Deerfield, Conway, and Greenfield. And our losses, again, were in the millions.
Yeah, sure.
But have paid out, or we anticipate paying out, $4.7 million just to stabilize. That's not even to fix anything. I mean, like, roads like Little Meadow Road are just, we're not even going to do anything. So we are in the $5 million range. What happened on September 11th was Leominster and Fitchburg had disasters. And Gil was in that group on the 16th, which
Andover
really
was in August.
And August was Andover. So there's a bunch of communities. I'm trying to organize them so that we can nail down when we're going to get some money. Natalie told me in August that they're anticipating before Thanksgiving, but this is mid-October, haven't heard a word.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't know if that's true or not. That's why we're going to the purpose of borrowing, because
cash flow,
just, we got to get stuff ready for winter. and
cash flow and credit rating.
And I talked to MEMA just recently. They have a total of before the September 11th storms, 11.1 million with just our towns, not Andover. So I know we're in the at least the $20 million range for asking for money, and we have over $5 million that we will be asking for Deerfield. So I don't know how long that's going to take, but I anticipate we'll get something. Will we get all 5.6 million? I don't know. But this is why we have to borrow money and potentially borrow money. I mean, and we're doing the best we can. We're only doing things to get stable. We're not fixing everything, and that people need to make sure that, you know, our restoration period is up to 5 years. There's grants that we're going to be applying for, several different kind of grants, and but everybody's chasing the same money. So I don't know how much we're going to get and when we're going to get them. It might take 2 or 3 rounds before we get to ours, and we can, you know, complain and whine and whatever. But we are hustling the bushes for money, but I am worried that we're going to have to go for the 5 million.
Yeah. So in terms of the repairs, I think most of you should already have this in front of you, but this is kind of what we're looking at right now. And then I think we're probably going to be having more roll in.
Yeah.
So we're at 4.1. And stuff that's already been stuff that's already rolled in as of October 16th, and then another 500,000 and change probably, right, to bring us up to the 4.7. So this has already been approved by the finance committee. So the way that this would be funded would be through borrowing. And it would be a debt exclusion vote that we would have, assuming this passes at town meeting.
Hey, I make a motion to move this forward. I don't think we have much choice.
No. Nope. Do we have a second?
I'll second.
All right. Any... Now if there's any other discussion or anything.
The only comments I have is that, you know, we're talking about this, and I think you've got to have really, you know, I'm sure you know this, but really good talking points for town meeting, very succinct, very to the point. Just be very blunt, because some people, you know, I look at social media and people just don't get it. You know, why aren't the sidewalks finished? Well, guess what? The sidewalks aren't finished because we had this massive storm. We have no money to finish the sidewalks. So I think you get what I mean. People don't understand. You have to make them understand.
I know.
Yeah.
We're going to talk about that tonight. So
you're doing the article, Carolyn?
Yeah.
Okay.
Good.
All right. Yeah. Any other Bader discussion? All right. All those in favor, we'll do a roll call vote. So we'll start with Carolyn.
Yes.
Denise.
Yes.
Chuck.
Yes.
Gary.
Yes.
Mark. Yes. And then in terms of priority, I think that this one's going to be pretty high. Denise, you have your hand up.
No, I'm giving it a one.
They're
all ones.
I don't think I would
not
really
approved, but it's health and safety, I would say, right?
Yeah.
Is that a two?
Yes.
Okay, two.
I just don't see, I mean, we've already spent the money, that's the problem.
Yeah, well, that's what I was gonna say, is like, you know, it's kind of a pre-approved, if you will. I mean, we had the, you know, the emergency. What's that?
We had to open the roads.
I think a one would be appropriate if anyone wants to make that motion.
I will make that motion.
All right.
I don't see how it cannot be a priority one because we've already, I mean, Brenda's already cut the checks.
Yeah. Yeah. Can we have a second?
Second.
All right. Okay. So any debate or discussion on making it a priority one? No? Okay. We'll do a roll call vote. Carolyn?
Yes.
Denise?
Yes.
Chuck?
Yes.
And Carrie?
Yes.
And Brennan, yes. All right. So that's it for the projects. And then I don't believe we had anything else that we needed to talk about. Any unanticipated business or anything?
Well, it's not really unanticipated, but I think, Casey, you're going to send out the applications for to all department heads for, you know, for December 1st deadline.
Yeah. So, yeah, that's a good point. So the upcoming meetings was the thing that I skipped over. So, yeah, we typically have those things. So for anyone who's new or not acquainted with the process, those are supposed to come in December, I think. Right, Casey? Sometimes we get them a little later than that. So what'll likely end up happening is, assuming we get a healthy amount of those in, sometime in December, I'll send an email out to everyone about your schedules. What I want to do this year is I want to try and tee up a bunch of meetings in January, February, and March, because this committee, by nature of, you know, being a kind of a cross-functional committee, we have to compete with all of your other meetings. I want to get in first this time so everyone can compete with us instead of us competing with everyone else. So
that sounds good.
Don't tell your friends. I want this to be a secret, even though it's recorded. But I'm gonna email everyone, you know, just to see if there's any dates or times or anything that are typically times where people are unavailable. And then, yeah, I'm just going to tee up a bunch of them so that way we can have all of our recommendations in order as early as possible.
I'm fine with that. Okay. Trevor, would you just remind everyone at the school committee if they were going to put in for capital?
Oh, yeah, that would be good.
Yes.
So we
talking about capital at the last meeting.
Because we, you know, the schools are usually the ones that are.
We've got a few things.
Yeah.
Yeah, like, I don't know, tennis court or anything. You know, it would be good if they talked about that, you know, on time. Denise, do you have something?
The borrowing starts Frontier. So, principal. So there'll be some stuff coming in on that. There's also, you know, the elementary school has some work to do for sure, I think.
Well, we want to make sure.
Here, I think we're going to.
I just went to a public health thing talking about, what we're having to anticipate, and we got to get the air conditioning for the kids because
we've got quite a bit going, and that's the second item. And then if they don't know about Eversource's grants, but if they can, they want to reinvest the grant money back, you know, the rebates back into, like last time I think we approved 6 and they got 11. Because we were able to kind of redo the rebates and roll it back in. So, and then there's some, you know, the general flooring, pulling up the carpets.
I just want to make sure that we get those air conditions in. Because I think that's, you know, I had a few complaints, but I know it's miserable.
It's so hot. I mean, it's just not so like
on both sides of the year now. Yeah.
That's right.
Yeah.
That's right.
Yeah. Well, parents wanted us to cancel school, you know, force the school to shut down. And those super hot days. I think Darius did a really good job.
We've got a lot done at both buildings.
I think it is important to make sure we have the air conditioning.
Yeah. We'll continue to work on that for sure.
All right. And then Denise.
Yeah. Just one really important point, because we dealt with this last year with the tennis courts. We've got to make it very clear who writes the application or who put, because we had an issue with that last year. I don't know who does it. Just whoever needs to do it needs to know that they need to do it.
Yeah, so the CPA funds.
So we have to go through that again. Okay. Cool.
Okay.
Yeah, but yeah, good point, Denise. Yeah. Thank you.
You're welcome.
I'll make a motion to adjourn then.
So we have a motion to adjourn on the floor. Do we have a second?
Second.
All right. Let's have to go through the ceremonies here. So Carolyn?
Yes.
Denise?
Yes.
Chuck?
Yes.
Harry?
Yes.
Mark Brennan, yes. Okay, great. We are adjourned.